In discussing software, we're going to start with webbing. There's flat webbing and tubular webbing. Typically speaking, flat webbing has a higher load design than what tubular webbing has, but is also more susceptible to catastrophic failure. So because it is a flat, single-stitched or single-woven component, if it does encounter a burr or something that's going to cut it when it's under tension, it will immediately rip apart. So in theory, you can correlate what flat webbing looks like to that of a seat belt type of element. Tubular webbing is typically going to have a stitched element in it that you can see through stitching tracers. You can also identify tubular webbing by taking that tubular webbing and rolling it around in your finger. If you can feel the two sides separate and form a tube, then you can identify that as some form of tubular webbing. Typically speaking, 1-inch tubular webbing has a design load of roughly 4,000 pounds. 2-inch tubular webbing will get you into the 6,000 pound range. So it's important when utilizing these webbing applications in life safety components that you're doing appropriate load design calculations to ensure that you're rigging the right device for the right job or the right objective that you have with that webbing. If utilizing webbing as anchor points, whether a wrap 3 pull 2 or a wrap 2 pull 1, whatever your applications are with that webbing, ensure that you're always utilizing it in pairs because of the susceptibility to catastrophic failure as well as those load design issues. We want to try and maximize the safety and the strength of webbing. It's also important to denote that one of the challenges when utilizing webbing applications in pairs is trying to get them to be the exact same length so that they truly share the load if being utilized in an anchor application. To connect the ends of webbing together, we're going to make sure that we utilize that water knot most of the time. One of the other downsides of flat webbing is that it's less likely to maintain the knots that are applied to it. So if utilizing flat webbing, we're strong encouragers or advocates of saying always put overhand safeties on the tails of your webbing coming out of those water knots to ensure that you don't lose the composition of that water knot. Prusa cord and rescue applications are typically going to be 7mm, 8mm, or 9mm. We're going to make that decision on what millimeter or diameter of prusa cord we use based on the loads that we're applying to our system and the overall applications. For our applications and typical practices, we're typically using at a minimum 8mm and preferably 9mm when applying highline operations at our anchor points. We want to ensure that we're not only maximizing the strength capacity of those prusik attachments as progress capture devices, but also the slip resistance. As we increase in diameter on our prusik cords, we also increase in the capacity that the overall system can absorb prior to the prusik starting to slip. A general rule of thumb that we utilize is 1,000 pounds of force will cause potentially a 7mm prusik to slip. We add 500 pounds of additional slip resistance to each diameter of prusik as we increase that prusik size. So if 7mm will slip at 1,000, we analyze 8mm as potentially slipping at 1,500 pounds, and we potentially analyze 9mm as potentially slipping at 2,000 pounds. Those are all based on actual working loads utilizing the dynamometer at the anchor point to see what those forces actually are that are being generated. So 7mm, 8mm, and 9mm are our primary choices. When we assemble our prusik cords, we utilize the double fisherman knot to attach the ends of those systems so that we have a complete loop. When utilizing tandem prusiks, there are some size variables, and typically we want to be 12 to 14 inches of overall difference in length between our long prusik and our short prusik. There are some basic margins utilizing high 50-inch applications and high 60-inch or low 70-inch applications between short and long prusiks. The reason that is a sliding scale is it's highly dependent on that primary pulley that's being utilized within that main hub for your directional with your progress capture device. If you're utilizing a very small prusik mining pulley, you're going to utilize shorter tandem prusiks to ensure that as those are being mined and then extend away from the system in a critical failure type of application, that they're going to travel as short of a distance as possible prior to securing the load or capturing that progress. If we're using a larger prusik minding pulley, then obviously these tandem prusiks are going to be a little bit longer so they can accommodate that additional distance of the side plates of the pulley, but still be an appropriate length so that they capture that load. So ensure when you're cutting your prusiks in tandem prusik applications that you're cutting them in an appropriate length designed around your prusik minding pulleys that you're using in your system. Our other or mainstay within software is our rope. In our rope, we're going to predominantly be dealing with anything above 10 mil. For our load release hitch applications, we're utilizing 10 mil rope. 9 millimeter rope is also an acceptable application for load release hitch applications. For our primary lifeline, for belay applications and lower haul applications, we're typically going to use half inch. In some other applications, particularly where rescuers are having to travel some distance in more mountainous environments or wilderness type environments, you may see a smaller diameter of rope, but in most of your urban settings for rescue applications, half inch is going to be our standard. We're going to use static Kern mantle, and we're going to make appropriate decisions based on sheath design, construction, and as well as performance of our rope to fit the needs of our department. Whether you're using nylon or polyester, you want to make sure that when you're selecting your rope, that it is integrated as a complete system between progress capture cord as well as primary lifeline. You want to make sure that the sheath designs on these systems are going to marry up with one another well and perform well when you're trying to capture loads. You want to make sure that you take appropriate care of all of your software, ensuring that it's clean, that you keep debris out of it, and that you use appropriate rope washing techniques as well as products when maintaining your rope. Always reference the load design capabilities as well as performance capabilities as well as maintenance requirements of the manufacturers of your rope and software systems.